Yes, human potentialities are indeed widespread. Yes, they are far too often suffocated by economic injustice and discrimination. Ladies and gentlemen, the faculties of the human mind, its potentialities, are not infinitely elastic. Sorry. Talent, let alone genius in the arts, is enigmatically rare and unpredictable. So it is in the gymnastics of the brain. The number of women of men and of men, of men and of women, qualified to respond to a chorus in Aeschylus, to categorical proof in Kant, to Edwino elegy in Rilke, may be larger than hierarchical reactionary ideologies assume. It is not, however, limitlessly large. The sciences have no hypocrisy about this. We do. We humanists lie to ourselves continually. The sciences say, sorry, you can't do an equation of the fifth degree, sorry, goodbye.
Welcome back. So for the remainder of this video, it might be a good idea to talk about what part genes play in ability and to correct some misconceptions there, before going on to talk about twin studies and if they tell us anything useful, and the Flynn effect and what James Flynn found. So, what part do genes play in our ability? Well, the increasing agreement that arguments about nature and nurture with fixed percentages allocated to each have sort of found their day, they've had their day. So we now recognize that it is in the interaction of our genes with the environment that is critical, and this will of course vary according to the situation. There is genetic factors in height. Tall parents will have taller children than shorter parents, but the environment will also play a crucial role in how this is expressed. For example, in a 50-year period, Japanese children reared in California were, on average, over a foot taller than children raised in Japan. Studies of cognitive development suggest that heritability plays only a minor role when children are growing up in a disadvantaged environment, because it is the environment that largely determines the levels of development. There are what we call, or might call, heritability confusions. When we read that height is 75% inherited, do we interpret this to mean as 3/4 of my height comes from my genes and that the environment is responsible for a further quarter? This will be inaccurate. Wrong. Heritability applies to a group, not an individual, and measures of variation within this group is that the fact that the 75% is only the differences in height. So if we talk about intelligence being 50% inherited, we are only talking about the differences between scores within a specific group, and not the total score. So, for example, even though having two ears is genetically determined, heritability is virtually zero, because there is little or no variance. We nearly all have two ears, right? So, these examples remind us that heritability is easy to misunderstand, and because it is based on correlations, never tells us about the causes of differences. What we are realizing, at least the scientific scholarly community of which I'm not really a part of, is that genes do have an important role, but this is much less direct and far more complex. So, any claim that there is a gene for maths or happiness or schizophrenia is guilty of misleading and being oversimplifying. What we now know is that there are complex behaviors which are multiply determined, and that is how genes are expressed that counts. So, for example, we are born with the capacity for developing complex language. So, whether we learn to speak it, how sophisticated our speech is, or what language we speak, is all down to the interplay with the environment. 2, when we're talking about how genes play an ability, we sometimes confuse inheritance with immutability. Inherited does not mean immutable. The unhelpful image of a genetic blueprint also feeds misconceptions about heredity. The mistake here is to see genetic patterns as immutable when in fact they can be modified. David Schenk offers us a helpful image, I think, of a giant control board in every cell in the body. Giant because there are over 20,000 genes in every cell, in which the genes are like volume knobs and switches. These can be turned up, down, off and on by another gene or by a minuscule environmental input. It's a continuous and active interaction from conception onwards, and it supports the claim that we develop rather than inherit traits. A powerful example of inherited does not mean immutable is the inherited condition of phenylketonuria, if I said that correctly, or PKU, a defect that can cause severe mental retardation. Newborns are immediately tested for this because an immediate change of diet can prevent the mutant DNA being expressed. Or, as the late scientist Stephen Jay Gould makes the point, the truly salient issues are malleability and flexibility, not fallacious passing by percentages. The trait may be 90% heritable, yet entirely malleable. A $20 pair of eyeglasses may fully correct a defect in vision that is 100% heritable. Let's step back a bit to recent history and the early nurture-nature debates, which were often focused on twin studies, particularly identical twins separated at birth. There was a good reason for this in their research design. Here is perhaps a perfect natural experiment. You find two identical twins who are separated at birth and raised in different environments, and from there you will be able to measure how much they have in common. Because they have identical genes, that will tell us how much they have influenced development, what is the same despite different nurture. All very neat in theory, but messier in reality, since very few identical twins are separated at birth and brought up in different environments. There is, or was, a public fascination with the similarities between separated identical twins, an example being the Jim twins, who got national coverage on US TV, and which in turn led to the funding of a large-scale research program led by Thomas Bouchard, and, not to mention, maybe a few movies inspired by the idea as well. So, who were the Jim twins and what were their surprising similarities? They were both born in Ohio in 1940 and separated at 4 weeks of age. They met again at age 39 and their lives had some uncanny resemblances. Not only were they both called Jim, of course, but they both had married a divorce, a woman named Linda, and then remarried a woman named Betty. They had each had an adopted brother called Larry and a childhood dog named Toy. They each liked maths but disliked spelling in school. They each named their firstborn James Allen and James Allen with a E. They each smoked Salem cigarettes and drank Miller Lite. They each enjoyed carpentry and mechanical drawing. They each chewed their nails, had migraine, and served as part-time sheriffs in their respective towns. They each drove the same model car. They each lived in the same region of Ohio and vacationed in Florida. And they each were around 6 feet tall and 180 pounds. Is this not a remarkable story with which to illustrate the power of genes? The media coverage certainly thought so, but if we take a step back, we may want to be a bit more cautious about what we read into this. For example, what have your genes got to do with the name your adopted parents gave you, or the naming of children, dogs, or the choosing of wives named Betty and Linda? The same goes for the same taste in cigarettes, bars, cars, holidays, whatever. Is there mileage in the alternative explanation that if you both grew up in a small town, blue-collar Ohio, as both twins did, we were likely to finish up, along with many others, with similar tastes in such things. The point here is that if we look for similarities, we can find them, and we may also ignore differences, of which there were many. Twin studies mean we cannot ignore genetic contributions, but we can also read too much into them and underestimate the interaction with the environment. So if we sometimes underestimate the contribution of the environment, what can James Flynn tell us? Well, James Flynn found that intelligence test scores have improved far too quickly over time to be simply explained in terms of genetic changes. His explanation, which sits more comfortably with the claims made in this video about expertise, is that the improvement over time was largely the result of social multiplier. The two key multipliers for him are the educational emphasis on 1. Scientific concepts and abstract classifications, and 2. The encouragement of, quote, on-the-spot problem-solving without a previously learned method. These so-called social multipliers encourage the very kind of thinking many IQ subtests require. So he then goes on to provide a trivial but telling example of similarities. He says, what dogs and rabbits have in common? Our grandparents may have given a functional response. We use dog to hunt rabbits. The required answer is they are mammals, perhaps, if we're talking about scientific concepts. For our grandparents, a big so what might follow, but 10-year-olds today will recognize this answer, even though most might have gone for a more concrete answer, that they both have four legs, for example. So to conclude then, for a very short video, how might we explain child prodigies and savants? When we see someone very young doing something very remarkable, it is easy to conclude they were born with a special talent. So, Tiger Woods is on TV at age 3 while Susan Polgar wins her first chess competition she enters at age 5, half the age of other competitors, and is world female under 16 champion at age 12. And then she goes on to become the first female grandmaster when she was only 22. Natural talent seems such an obvious explanation, especially if we don't look too closely at what has gone before each of these impressive debuts. Anders Ericsson has warned us about the so-called iceberg illusion, paying attention to the visible and not to the far bigger base that underpins it, hence the metaphor. Michael Howe observes that prodigies have, quote, almost always received very considerable help and encouragement prior to the time at which their ability has been seen to be remarkable, end quote. None of this denies that child prodigies are remarkable, and looking at how they learn their skills simply increases our admiration of them, arguably. Taking the easy route and declaring they are different from the rest of us as a result of inborn talents does not do justice to their efforts. Take Mozart's musical output. David Schenk, who we've heard from earlier, points out that when what are recognised as his great works, for example Symphony No. 29, came 10 years after his first symphonies, while his first great piano concerto, No. 9, written at age 21, was his 271st completed composition. What is widely regarded as his first operatic masterpiece, Idomeneo, was in fact his 13th opera. Mozart felt this lack of recognition for his efforts. In a letter to his father, he wrote, "People make a great mistake who think that my art has come easily to me. Nobody has devoted so much time and thought to composition as I. There is not a famous master whose work I have not studied over and over." So much for effortless mastery then. What we've just been discussing about savants and prodigies is perhaps a separation of inherited resources from, quote, natural ability, but two things that are perhaps in fact more analytically inseparable than we might want to think. Furthermore though, the separation of natural ability from inherited resources is analytically unachievable, but also useful. Where I live in North London, there's been a huge explosion in private tuition, for example, with more privileged students, both private and state pupils. And there's good reason for this. Education is one of the means through which reproduction of social advantage can take place in the 21st century, it seems. But that's to slightly get off on a tangent. Your reaction to the arguments in this video, incomplete and perhaps lacking rebuttals, may be to declare that I am simply attacking straw men. We all know that ability is developed and we've all moved on from the simple idea that IQ is fixed. I would be pleased if we were right and we were just simply all fighting old battles. But, for example, the 2009 comment from Chris Woodhead, the former chief inspector of schools in England, suggests that we're not simply fighting old wars. He said, "I think it would be unlikely that large numbers of grammar school kids would come from these disadvantaged areas. Their genes are likely to be better if your parents are teachers, academics, lawyers, whatever, and the nurture is likely to be better. Why do we think that we can make him, not very bright Jimmy, brighter than God made him?" As educators and practitioners in education, without invoking the Almighty, we can see how we might improve the so-called Jimmy and his abilities without having to despair and sink into fatalism. Thanks for your time, and I will see you in the next video.